Chuck, we're welcoming Scott Shepard back to Blunt Force Truth. Now, Scott is with the
Project 21
group. Thank you. And he is a fellow at the National Center, as well as the director of the National Center for Free Enterprise Project, conservative movement, only full service shareholder activation education program. So, folks, and by the way, he has taught law school and been a lawyer. We're not holding that against him. But, folks, you may remember that Scott's group is the you're the guys who go out and buy stock in companies so you can show up at the shareholder meetings.
So that's not going to be a question because I've got the very first question, Scott.
All right.
Here's my question.
What's your question, caller?
Has the FBI showed up at your door yet, armed with guns and ready to subpoena you?
Well,
because it seems like they're going after everybody else.
I figure I'm on their list. I know I'm on Larry Fink and Brian Moynihan's list because I point out their hypocrisy fairly often. But, you know, I moved recently, couldn't stand blue state life anymore. I moved a little bit into West Virginia. So I've got all sorts of neighbors who are well-armed allies. So maybe they'll stay away from me for a little while longer.
So you're gonna turn West Virginia into Ruby Ridge here at some point?
I haven't been here that long, but I don't feel like I was the spark necessary to provide that impetus to West Virginia.
Oh, West Virginia is interesting, isn't it?
I grew up right next door to West Virginia. I'm from Ashland, Kentucky. So right across the bridge was Huntington, or actually Catlettsburg. And Catlettsburg was next to Sarita Canova, which runs into Huntington, West Virginia.
Yeah, those just roll right off the tongue, don't they?
Sarita Canova and Catlettsburg.
Who named these places?
It was long before I was there, so I have no idea.
So, Scott, you're going to talk to us about something, and folks, I want you to pay attention. We're going to talk about something that's going on in Australia, and you would think that what's going on in Australia is irrelevant to us. But what happens around the world is not irrelevant to us because oftentimes these are the testing grounds. These are the places where things are being tested. So, Scott, let's start by what you're concerned about in Australia.
Yeah. And as a predicate, what you were just saying, it's certainly true that we have to pay attention to what's happening everywhere now because the World Economic Forum, Klaus Schwab, that Larry Fink and Brian Moynihan and all the other insurrectionists in the
C-suite.
Bill Gates. They spread this information. They try these things out in various countries and use them as models and templates for the rest of us. So, and already it started to flow into California. So
I was going to say the closest to them is California, and that's where it hit next.
That's right.
By the way, Scott, before you get this, what the hell has happened to Australia? They used to really kind of be into
I was just going to ask exactly the same thing as a predecessor to this whole interview. What did happen to Australia?
That's a fantastic question because it's not just that they submitted to, they had Australia, New Zealand submitted to lockdowns more barbarous than just about anywhere other than China. But about 15 years ago, they gave up all their guns. When I was a kid, Australians were maybe tougher than us.
They were more freedom. They were 20 years more into freedom than we were. We were 20 years further down the progressive road than they were. Yeah. And now they have just hit the accelerator and flew past us.
That's right. That's right. And you see it throughout their society, throughout the government. And now you see it. Australia Bank, which is not the Bank of Australia. This isn't full national policy yet, but one of the significant banks in Australia has declared that it's no longer going to lend money to people who want to buy cars or trucks, want to buy normal cars and trucks to go as long as they need to go rather than having to stop to be refilled at a broken charging station for half.
So apparently they have an incredible infrastructure for electricity, correct?
Well, they're hammering their whole infrastructure, electricity infrastructure down too, because they've dropped coal, they're at light speed, trying to get away from reliable energies to go for what they call renewable and clean energies, which are neither. But in addition, this bank has said, from now on, we're only lending for EV cars. At the same time, and this is during California, at the same time as one of the states of Australia, it might have been Victoria or well, who cares? One of the states of Australia had to call blackouts in an energy emergency. And so flip over to California. Gavin Newsom announced that by 2035, new car sales in California would all have to be
EV. And then a week later, he asked you not to charge your electric car.
That's right. And he did that standing in a building so cold that he was wearing a fleece when it was 120 degrees outside.
Yeah, we all saw French laundry.
That guy's a monster, and he's trying to run for president. So that's another problem that we all wish could just be California's alone, but it's all of our problem.
So now let me follow up on this here. So Australia, we got a company or a bank that doesn't want to loan money for gas-powered cars. And do I understand that there's an issue with white people applying for loans also?
Well, oh, yes. You mean at Bank of America? Yeah, it's been quite a couple of weeks.
Bank of America. Yes, Bank of America.
Bank of America, headed by billionaire Brian Moynihan, who I should point out is white and lives like a billionaire.
Don't tell him.
That's right. Maybe he thought
he's self-identifying.
A poor black man.
Right.
But he's instituted a policy at Bank of America whereby you can qualify for no down payment mortgages. And remember how well they went last time.
That worked out great in 2008.
But in order to get one, you have to have a certain minimum income level, which suggests not perhaps the best people to give no down payment mortgages to. But then you also have to buy a house in a black or Hispanic community.
To get a loan. Oh, okay. Yep.
Isn't that called reverse redlining?
Yeah, I spend so much of my time saying that all racism is racism. I feel like I should also start saying that all redlining is redlining.
But it is redlining because you're saying we'll give you money as long as you don't move where the white people live. Isn't it? Isn't that what that just said?
Yeah, basically, that's what they're saying.
One of the effects of this will be to fund further segregation and to fund the ending of desegregation, which... See, I thought that's been a goal of ours for 60 years, but not anymore. Bank of America is against desegregation. And of course, it's given so much money to Black Lives Matters and other groups. And Brian Moynihan's all about equity for others. He keeps his billions, but we all get poorer so that equity could happen.
I'm still dying here. We'll give you money for a house as long as you don't live where the white folks live.
Well, and keep in mind, the white folks can't move in and create desegregation that way.
Oh, so that's the idea.
Colonialism and white supremacy and gentrification. And Brian Moynihan thinks all those things are terrible. So
what we're really trying to do is keep the white people out of the black community.
Well, I think what happened is Bank of America really wanted to have a program that said, we'll just subsidize, we'll give no down payment loans just to black and Hispanic people. But
why? Because this is not going to be profitable business, or is the government backing all this?
Well, it's not going to be profitable business in the old-timey sense of 2 or 3 years ago. The fiduciary duty meant making money for your shareholders.
Right.
But it's profitable in the profitability sense of Brian Moynihan expiating his unnecessary guilt for being rich.
Oh, yeah.
And that's the profit standard at Bank of America.
You know, I have that same issue. Sometimes I feel really guilty, and then typically what I do is I get in one of my incredibly expensive cars and go out for a long drive until it kind of fades away.
You know, I must tell you something. Maybe this is my callous. I didn't grow up wealthy.
Nor did I. Jim Martin.
You know that. Didn't either.
You didn't have a lot of money in Ashland, Chuck?
We were probably lower middle class right in that area. We weren't poor or anything like that, but everybody else was in the same boat, so we didn't notice.
Yeah.
But anyway, the point, I never felt like I had to apologize for making a lot of money when I lived in Beverly Hills and I walked down to Nate Nall's to get a lunch with my kids. And there were three people standing in front of Nate Nall's with, in a wheelchair and everything else and begging for money. Okay. All right. Now that sounds callous, but we also found out that these three people would fold up their wheelchairs and walk back to their BMWs I mean, it's just, it's insane, this whole guilt trip that everybody is on, the liberal side anyway. I don't know whether, maybe conservatives are doing the same thing. I don't know, but I never felt that way.
Well, I don't think conservatives are doing it because there's an arc to that. Have you ever heard the shirt sleeves rule? That within, it's families come up from the lower middle class, and the progenitor of the family gets rich. Starts in his shirt sleeves and gets rich. And within three or four generations, that family will be back to its shirt sleeves because the second generation feels guilty. The third generation is lazy and the fourth generation is worthless.
I'll tell you something else too, Scott, and that is if you really analyze education in this country, you see that...
What education?
Well, I'm talking about college education.
Well, and I say again, what education?
Okay, college attendance.
Okay.
So you will see, let's go with college degrees. If you really study wealth in this country, you see that the majority of wealth in this country was built by people without college degrees, and then their wealth paid for their children to have college degrees.
You know, there was a joke when I grew up, and maybe it's still around today. I really don't know because I haven't been on the campus forever. But we used to talk about these degrees that people would get, like they would get degrees in underwater basket weaving. That was like the big joke. Oh, he's got a degree. But yeah, it's in underwater basket weaving. So just any way you can put a, you know, an asterisk behind your name and say, I got a college education and everything else. Today, it's far worse than that.
Well, I told you, I went and got a PhD just to prove it was worthless.
Yeah, right.
Just because by having it, it gives me the credibility of saying it's useless. See, if I didn't have one and people would just say I was jealous because I didn't have one. So now, I have one, and it's worthless.
Now, we had a guy on who's very bright. I mean, I can't think of his name right now. He's been in the news off and on when COVID was around in the very beginning. He had a PhD from MIT. He had a PhD from Harvard. He had four PhDs.
Dr. Shiva Iyadora.
Yes. And he said, you know, I just got all these PhDs to show that they were worthless.
Yeah, he actually went and got a Harvard PhD so he could have the credibility of saying Harvard was a dump school that was of no value.
Well, Harvard just hired Brian Stelter. So there's no, the jury's not.
Yeah, well, there you go. Oh, man.
But you know, we were better off in the days of underwater basket weaving degrees because at least they were useless, but they were harmless.
But you could make a basket. Eventually, you could get a very waterlogged basket out of it. Right. Now we have degrees in women's studies.
That's right. Well,
gender studies.
You can't say women's studies because that excludes somebody.
Now, by the way, I'm going to ask you two guys. I don't know about me. When I was 16, women's studies was pretty much the focus of what I was doing. Did I get a degree in that?
We were all studying women, as you know.
There's a lot of age.
We possibly could. And they were studying us, too.
Exactly. There was no university degree necessary for any of that. Mm-hmm. So, Scott, tell us what's going on the corporate front across America these days.
Well, a lot more of the grimness we were just talking about. Bank of America, my organization is suing, the National Center is suing Starbucks with terrific lawyers of the American Civil Rights Project, Dan Mornoff, and we're suing them. This is the Rube Goldberg racism contraption that they've put together. Listen to this. So they've set what they're pleased to call goals or targets, but are really quotas, on hiring by race and ethnicity at Starbucks. And they've got a floor of 30% at executive levels and 40% in other levels at the company for racial or ethnic minorities, which means caps of 60% and 70% for white people. And then to make sure that the executives and managers who hire and promote know exactly what they're doing, they've developed a diversity dashboard. So everyone knows exactly the race and ethnicity of everybody who reports to them. So much for
isn't that illegal?
Well, it should be illegal all by itself.
But I thought asking someone their race when you were interviewing them or hiring them was forbidden.
Well, I thought it was too, because all of this is illegal. I mean,
so I have to guess at it. I have to just look at you and guess at what you are.
But that had been the rule for so long. But now, so that's step two. And then in step three, they change the way they pay their executives so that the executives should get paid more if they hit these goals, which is what makes them quotas.
This brings a whole new meaning to the term black coffee, doesn't it?
Well, you know, I've always held Starbucks coffee in such disdain. It tastes so bad.
You know, I was just going to say that. I mean, I have two young sons who drink coffee, and they will not. They hate Starbucks.
Yeah.
My wife hates Starbucks.
Coffee. See, bulletproof coffee. That's the plan.
But the point is, they're very, very popular places. There's no question about it until they changed their bakery, which really screwed everything up for me.
They got rid of using the bathrooms as injection sites, though, didn't they? Because didn't they open up all their bathrooms for drug addicts, and then they found out drug addicts kept filling their bathrooms?
Yeah, that strange cause and effect problem. Of course, you know, Starbucks has a terrible cause and effect understanding. They had to get Howard Schultz back for yet another time. Because they didn't think through that in supporting all this equity and wokeness and left-wing nonsense, they were de facto encouraging reunionization. And the reunionization has come to bite them. And they supported defunding the police and making cities postmodern hellholes. But now, gosh golly, they're finding they have to close stores in Portland and St. Louis. I'm sorry, Portland and Seattle. And San Francisco, because all of the things they propose, all of the things they stand up for are terrible for everyone, including them.
Now, I notice nobody's having to shut down a Dunkin' Donuts.
That's right. That's right. And also, that's much, much better coffee. You know, but beyond them, we've got, well, let me tell you about some victories, some at least minor victories. We've been working, as I say, with the ACR project and pushing on a lot of these companies. And all of them are up to some kind or other of equity-based discrimination on the basis of race or sex or orientation or all three.
Okay, let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
The word equity has been thrown around for the last year, I guess, maybe longer. It's a new word. It's a new term. It used to be equality. Now it's equity.
Well, yeah. I mean, equity used to mean, you know, how much of your house did you actually own and how much did the bank own?
Exactly. So my question to you is, what does equity mean?
Yeah. Well, I'll quote from one of its great progenitors, Ibram Kendi, who explains it this way.
One of my favorites.
Yeah. Equity means discrimination now to make up for other discrimination by other people against other people in the past. To be anti-discrimination is to be white supremacist. You have to be pro-discrimination against whites and men and straight people, or you're a racist.
So two wrongs actually make a right now.
Well, to his mind, but there's another half of this. He also says that everywhere he sees a disparity of outcome, anywhere on the basis of race or sex orientation, then that demonstrates white supremacy, male supremacy, straight supremacy, whatever the terms are, such that more discrimination has to occur until there's equality of outcome. In other words, this is racism and sexism in pursuit of socialism.
So why can't I be in the NBA?
That's what Larry Fink and Brian Moynihan think are the way to go.
So why can't I play in the NBA?
Well, I've wondered that too. I mean, there's a lot of anti-white systemic racism in the major sports these days. I mean, not hockey. Somehow hockey's avoided that plague, but, you know.
And skiing.
That's right.
Ice skating and skiing.
Anything to do with cold? The white people still seem to be holding on to the cold stuff. We're holding, you know, white people kind of dominate auto racing too. But they claim that the reason for auto racing is because it's too expensive to get in.
Do you realize how ridiculous this conversation really is?
Most of our conversations are ridiculous, Chuck.
No, that's not. You know, I mean, this whole conversation that we're having about what's happening to our country is truly ridiculous.
Well, I mean, and it's insane that we're having this in 2022. We are scoring some victories, but did you hear the development with the AMA that it's only going to accredit medical schools if they discriminate on the basis of race and lower standards for blacks and other minority groups so that they can get into college or to medical school, even though they haven't hit the numbers and then get through medical school? Well, that might be the most anti-black racist thing that anybody's ever heard. It demeans black candidates. And then everybody knows, because the AMA has demanded it, that there will be doctors in the system who you can tell who they are because they're the ones who benefited from this program, who didn't have the skill set that other doctors did. So you're injecting with a pressure hose, injecting activity that looks racist but isn't, because you've injected a difference in quality into the system. That's evil.
Well, there's the old joke about, you know, what do you call the guy who graduates bottom of his class in medical school? Doctor.
Yeah, that's right.
And that's what we're talking about here. We're now talking about essentially infiltrating the ranks of medicine with incompetent people on the grounds of equity, on racial equity.
Yeah.
So who's going to be the patient for these people? You can bet that nobody in Congress or the Senate is going to see these people as their doctors.
Well, no, of course not. But also, if given that Bank of America is subsidizing resegregation, if we assume that people are just by happenstance of where they live more likely to see doctors who look like them than doctors that don't, then this supposed effort to end inequity and help minority groups is going to send underqualified doctors, because they weren't held up to the same standards, into primarily serving minority patients. How does that help anyone?
It doesn't. I've been watching, as the whole world has, the coverage of the Queen dying in England and Charles taking over as king. And the left, and especially black people on the left, on MSNBC, on CNN, and the New York Times, Washington Post, all the, you know, suspicious characters are saying, yes, but, you know, because everybody's lauding her and saying what a wonderful queen she was. She served for 7 years. And she, you know, she did all this. She didn't make a misstep. She's beloved by her country and everything else. But wait a minute. What about that colonialization of her country over the few hundred years that they were in opera? And I say to them, well, what about the colonialization of Portugal? What about the colonialization of Spain? What about we're the only country that never fell into the trap of colonizing anything.
Yeah.
However, well, look at every place that they accuse. Look at all the countries they accuse the UK of colonializing. And now look at the condition of those countries, many of them, now that the UK has left them.
Well, when the British colonized something, they really attempted to leave behind good government. That's what their legacy was. When the French colonized places, they left behind good food. Forget the government.
Well, I mean, both of those points are true. India, the idea that India was better off or less violent before the Raj started or after it ended than during it is absurd. And that was, of course, the jewel in the imperial crown.
I would suggest our audience to read a book by two friends of mine, Larry Collins and Dominic LaPierre, and it's called Freedom at Midnight. It's an older book, I think, written in the 70s, but it will tell you everything that happened in transferring or relieving Britain of their power in India and what happened to them and how. And
Matt's going to put a link to it in the show notes, Chuck.
Yeah, I hopefully you can still get it. But I read it, you know, I read it back in the 70s. It was absolutely enlightening as far as geopolitical understanding of that whole part of the world. And just
it's still available on Amazon.
Is it?
Yes.
Good. It's like $5 on Kindle.
It's $5 on Kindle. It's a great, great read. And it's called Freedom at Midnight. And it's interesting because when the king came to Winston Churchill and said, look, I want you to go over and this transfer of power has to take place. And Winston Churchill said, I want nothing to do with this. I don't want anything. So they ended up getting, what was the man's name? It was killed by the IRA. What was it? Lord Mountbatten. So Lord Mountbatten and his wife went over and they accomplished what nobody else wanted to even get their feet wet in. And it's a fabulous book. But anyway, go ahead. Where were we? Before I took us completely off the trail.
As we're talking about colonialism and reparations and everything.
Yeah, I mean, this is what this is all born out of, isn't it? Yeah. Slavery, colonialization, all of this is all of this stuff today is born out of what was in the past that has actually been rectified, but we're still being blamed for it.
Well, but why don't we consider, as you say, everybody's colonialization?
Everybody in Europe.
Huh? The Muslims took over all of the Maghreb, all of North Africa, came to Vienna, went up through Spain, and still they took over the Holy Lands. Aren't they paying reparations to all of
them? And on top of that, they were in Northern Africa and other parts of Africa, and they were the slave sellers.
There's still slavery in Muslim countries. Why isn't that awful woman in Michigan paying us? And why do we want to pay her reparations when her culture did at least as much as our culture did? And we certainly didn't do it to her. Why didn't she go home if she doesn't want, if things are this bad here? Why would we pay somebody? It's all just insane.
It is insane. It is insanity we're living in.
Well, you also look
at holding people responsible for things that they never did.
You notice the members of Congress that are screaming the most about student loan forgiveness are still sitting on student loans.
Yes. Mm. Well, I'll tell you what, I paid off. Interest rates were high in the 90s, and I had to pay to turn evil myself. I paid for law school. And so, you know, I paid over the years.
Don't you feel stupid now?
For paying?
Yeah.
Well, I might feel stupid for going to law school, but I definitely feel stupid for paying for law school.
You could have went and got a loan and done a gender studies program and think about how much better off you'd be right now.
That's right. Boy, I'd be much angrier, but I'd get carried on MSNBC. Well, no, wait, I'm a white guy, so I wouldn't get carried on MSNBC regardless.
No.
Well, if you basically self-flagellate yourself, you know, for hours and confess your evil whiteness.
That's right.
This is like a scene out of Game of Thrones. Remember when she walked naked, this woman who was Joffrey's mother?
Yeah, she was.
She walks naked through the street and people were lined up and saying, shame, shame. I mean, it's what we're going through today. Except it's not one person.
And to teach at so many of these higher ed schools, you have to sign up for a diversity statement or an equity statement that is essentially the old Cultural Revolution style self-abnegation. I apologize for owning, for taking up the land that wasn't mine. Yeah, mm-hmm. If we did that all the way around the world, everybody would have to apologize to everybody.
Right.
But, you know. Yeah.
So I think what people need to understand is when we look at the left, we make jokes about this and we talk about their craziness and things of that nature. But what we're really looking at is an ideology and a religion.
Yeah.
And they believe this. Now, this doesn't mean that the typical Democrat voter really is that deep into and understands it, but those at the top of the food chain on this, and those from the 60s radicals, really attached to this. And I did some work on this. I'll share it with you quickly. This really comes out of Antonio Gramsci and out of Michael Foucault. That's where this stuff comes from.
You need to tell people who they are because they have no idea.
Well, Antonio Gramsci was from Italy. He was imprisoned in Italy under Mussolini's government and wrote the book Prison Notebooks. And this has become the ideology of the left. This is where they got this stuff from the 60s.
So he was a communist and not a fascist.
Correct.
And it's very interesting. This is fascinating to me. It's great to be a communist no matter where you are, yeah, as far as governments and public and school and everything else. But fascism, no. And they're same thing, basically.
Same thing. Well, and to the degree they're even slightly different, it's because
slightly is right.
Envisioned a partnership between big business and big government in order to restrain civil liberties and people's rights and free government. And if you look at who's being the fascist today, it's certainly not the right.
They always project.
And Brian Moynihan at the top of these companies and the Silicon Valley twits, Mark Zuckerberg having Tony Fauci's personal email or cell phone number so that they could get together and do what it would be censorship and criminal for the government to do itself. There's your fascism.
Well, let me give you the base of this. When we look at Gramsci's and we look at Foucault's writing, and let me give you the basis of it. for Gramsci, his basic was that the underclass are exploited people from the ever learning and from, and they are exploited and prevented from learning of their oppression. So he said that the task of the radicals at that point is to seize control of the institutions in order to propagate the revolutionary ideology. This started happening in the late 1960s with student radicals influenced by Gramsci. Gramsci is where Hillary comes from. Gramsci is where Bernie Sanders comes from. It is the core of where these people came from, and they grew up taking these positions. Now, the positions is that America is evil. Now we have to go over to Foucault, who, by the way, was also charged with molesting young boys, but it's a thing. He was actually one of their other most important thinkers. Now, here's his position. Exploited and oppressed minorities are deserving of our sympathy because they have done nothing wrong. Their criminality is conjured up, created, and forced upon them by the real criminals, the majority, which scapegoats the minority. So from his perception, the minority is always right and virtuous. So his problem is that America is evil, reinforced by the institutions which propagate those values to the next generation. Thus, the anti-American progressive needed to seize businesses, media, churches, schools to promote their new revolutionary ideology, which will free the masses from the lies of white freedom, white courage, white capitalism, white Christianity, white law and order. What their position is simply this. Anything that is structural in America is controlled by white people. Anything that represents white people, cities, buildings, law enforcement, statues, needs to be destroyed. The reason they are pro-crime, and I really wanted to understand, why do Democrats like crime? And it's really got to these philosophies. And the reason they support crime is because they think crime is a white construct. They believe that white power has constructed a system where these people are forced into crime. So they're not responsible for the crime because we made them commit the crime. And that the only way to fix that is to not find them to be criminals. And this is why your group going after corporations is so important, because part of their goal is to seize the universities and the schools and the government, and then they have to seize the major corporations. They have to seize the Fortune 500 type companies to implement this entire philosophy. We are facing a religion.
Yeah, you're absolutely. And you're absolutely right that it's been the plan, and they had a name for this plan. They borrowed it from Chairman Mao. So that tells you quite a lot about what they had in mind. But they called it the Long March Through the Institutions. And what you just said is exactly what they did. And they took over higher education. Even when I went to school 30 years ago, there was still some room to be a conservative on campus. Now they've totally taken over higher ed. They've taken over Hollywood. They've taken over and utterly destroyed what used to be the news media. They've taken over the civil service. They've taken over, as we saw in Loudoun County a year or two ago, and now it's happening everywhere. They're taking over regular education. They're going to
now they need the corporations.
And the only things that they have left are corporations and the military, and they're going after both of them with absolute precision. And so what we on the right have to do, and if it's easy to get angry with our side, because our side is so often just useless. But what we have to do this time is recognize that their long march has been so nearly completely successful that winning a couple of battles at corporations or winning the whole corporate arena back is just the beginning. We have to fight all the way back to a time when half of the faculty at whatever university still exists at that time are right of center. Not because we've set up quotas, but because we've cut out the real systemic discrimination, which is against conservatives and just basically sensible people at higher ed and in Hollywood and everywhere else. And until we do that, we're always fighting in the last ditch.
So when we're fighting for diversity on universities, what you're saying is we really need to be fighting for diversity of thought in college campuses and in schools.
Yeah.
I mean, imagine if somebody passed a law saying that legally, forget about who's white and red and green and blue. What if we passed a law saying that the makeup of the professors at a university had to be ideologically balanced?
Well, I would just settle for some state laws that forbid discrimination on the basis of viewpoint in higher education, and that if there are certain massive levels of overrepresentation by the left, that will be taken as per se evidence of discrimination. So use their systemic theory against them. Let them know that inequality of outcome or inequality of representation represents systemic bigotry that has to be fought away. Well, I mean, there is no more bigoted place than the higher ed. And so, you know, it's especially where it's paid for by state taxpayers, but also now that we're writing off student loans by the whole federal taxpayer system, we should all be demanding absolute viewpoint non-discrimination in higher ed.
We need to fight for diversity of position or diversity of thought.
Yeah.
I was saying to Chuck last week on the show, I was in Indianapolis and I went to the Kurt Vonnegut Museum that's right in Indianapolis. And as you remember, Kurt Vonnegut was far left. He was a radical. But on the building, they have famous quotes from him written on the walls, which now all look like quotes from us. Because his quotes were that, you know, all positions, all thoughts need to have equal airing. And that no single voice should be suppressed regardless of how you disapprove of their position. Everything that he was complaining and arguing for in the 60s and 70s is now what they're doing.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Fahrenheit 451 is probably one of his most famous. And that was a cri de coeur against censorship. And so in the digital age, it's Zuckerberg and Parag Agrawal and that whole clown show out in Silicon Valley, who are the primary opponents of everything that Vonnegut thought.
But look at this. I mean, let's just take climate change, for instance. There's no debate on climate change. There never has been. It's like Fetterman debating Dr. Oz.
Right.
They're hiding. You know, everybody votes on it first, and then they have a debate.
Yeah, he'll debate after the vote.
So it's like they have convinced people of this scam called climate change. And the reason they've convinced is because there's nobody's dissenting. No scientists are coming forward and saying, well, let's debate this. They won't debate it. So they shut down debate completely, and there's only one side.
Now, we have a scientist, by the way, Scott, that was on our show last week. His name is Dr. Cohen.
Yeah.
Honor Cohen. And Dr. Cohen offers I forget what it is, but many thousands of dollars to anyone.
$50,000
to anyone who will debate him successfully on how climate change is a scam. And no one will take him up on this bet.
They don't want to debate it. If you debate it, you're exposed.
Well, you can tell how many ways it's a scam by how many things they just absolutely block out. Like I deal with the executives more than anybody else, and so I'm more familiar with the stupid that they come up with. But China and India have made it perfectly clear they're not going to decarbonize. Most of the developing world wants to get rich. It wants no part of this left-wing rich country fetish. And so they're not going to do it. If they don't do it, then nothing that the West does can matter.
Of course not.
We've been hearing every 12 years that we've got 12 years left back from when I was in high school.
Even if they did do it, it wouldn't matter.
Well, right. But so all of those predictions were either wrong or they were right. If they were right, it's too late and we've got to ramp the economy to deal with the consequences. But if they were wrong, then there's no conceivable reason to believe that 80 predictions up to this one were wrong, but this one's magically somehow right. Or at least you'd have to prove that with an astonishing amount of hard, fully vetted evidence. And nobody in this racket does that. But everything about it is BS.
So carbon neutral atmosphere produces what? Do you have any idea? Because I do. I know exactly what it produces.
A carbon neutral atmosphere? Meaning what? Meaning getting back to where we were in 1980? Or?
No carbon anywhere. Carbon neutral. That's what they're after, carbon neutral. So
an atmosphere empty of carbon would mean the instant death of all things.
It would mean an ice age coming right now.
And reducing CO2 means less food.
Well, it's less everything, but you'll freeze your butts off. It'll kill everybody off. This stuff is so ridiculous. It's unbelievable.
Let me throw something at you guys for a minute. I don't know if you guys have been paying attention to this. Scott, have you been following all of the mysterious destruction that is happening at food plants?
I've just enough to have seen the stories, and every time I see one, I think, what? Now, I don't know the statistics, and so often with the way things get reported in the press, you just hear about something because everybody started noticing it, like when you learn a new word and then everybody seems to be saying that word.
Right.
But so I'm not sure what the statistics are, but it certainly seems like something that somebody ought to be looking into.
It's a coincidence.
In the past year, there have been 96 disasters at food processing plants here in the U.S.
What was it the year before?
Like 8.
Bro.
So are we...
It's kind of like crime.
Are we creating a food shortage?
Well, we know that we're creating an energy shortage.
But would we believe that there could be powers at hand that are so twisted and so evil that they are deliberately creating a food shortage?
Oh, yeah. I mean... Well, I don't know about absolutely deliberately, but one of the environmental minister or agriculture minister in Germany just over this past weekend said, look, the fact that people might be hungry is no reason to stop our decarbonization push. So,
or freezing to death.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's going to be a disaster in Europe this winter. Those people.
Well, the fact that Trump was right about that is just really annoying to them.
Yeah.
How bad do you think Europe is going to be this winter?
Well, I think it's going to be cold, and I think it's funny how all these shibboleths just disappear when they're inconvenient for whatever lunatic thing the left wants to do today. Saving old growth forests is, in some places and in some days, the very most important thing in the world. Now in Germany, that doesn't matter anymore because they're going to have firewood to stay alive this winter, and so that doesn't matter. And also, this was less true here, but about a decade ago, GMO foods, genetically modified products, were absolutely Monsanto, and it was a terrible nightmare, and American corporations were trying to kill everybody. Now these exact same people are calling for meat made out of bugs and milk made out of, I don't know, chemicals concoction and hope. And that's just, that's somehow not genetic engineering. That's loving the planet.
Well, if we start burning trees to heat houses, what's the byproduct of burning wood in a fireplace? Because it's not very efficient.
Well, I mean, neither is making yourself so dependent on Russia and turning your nose up on natural gas that you have to revive your oldest coal plants. But that's where Europe's gotten itself.
I mean, we look at pictures of 19th century London. And the smoke and the fog hung over the city because of all the coal burning.
Yeah. Well,
because burning in fireplaces isn't efficient.
There's a deeper point in that, Mark, which is that it's been proven throughout modern history that the way to make a place cleaner and healthier is to make it wealthier. And the way you do that is not to regulate into perdition and destroy reliable energy, which is absolutely necessary for modern economies. The way to do that is to cut regulation, get the heck out of the way, and make everybody wealthier so that they're willing to buy cleaner living standards. And if we'd stopped in 1920, when everything was covered in the London fog and coal dust, and started decarbonizing from there, all the magic of the last 100 years wouldn't happen. And it would still be a vastly dirtier place than it is today. So just everything about decarbonization is nonsense.
And you see, California is now kind of rethinking shutting down their last horrible, dangerous nuclear plant.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, anything to keep the narrative going. And they've realized that even the French Laundry might not be fully heated if we completely decarbonize.
Well, I don't think that's acceptable. But I'm looking at this list here. 96 different food plants. We're talking about Smithfield, Kellogg, Patak, Tyson, Made Right. I mean, it's unbelievable. Some of them, the animals have been destroyed. Some of them, the buildings have burned down. I mean, it's the odds on 96 food plants having a disaster seems just kind of odd to me.
Yeah. Yeah, it certainly does. The saddest part of it is today, you start by wondering why the FBI isn't getting on this, and you end by wondering if they don't somehow have something to do with it, given everything else they're up to.
There appears to be little to no investigation going on.
Well,
I mean, and actually the last of the 96 disasters, by the way, was the irrigation water canceled in California, which is the number one producer of food in the U.S. And instead, the water was flushed directly out of the Delta instead of to the food.
There was a movie called Chinatown that was all about water rights in the valley. Then they were caught doing exactly the same thing, flushing it all in the ocean.
Right. Instead of allowing it to be used on crops.
Well, you know, those Delta smelt in the in the Sacramento Delta are acre per acre, because they're so tiny, the most valuable things in human history, because so much that potential production has been just sloughed away down through the Delta to protect these completely pointless fish.
So what's your next move on corporate America?
Well, we have sent some other demand letters out to other companies that are doing things similar to what Starbucks is doing. As I say, victories at Google and at IBM this week and some others. But we're going to keep on top of the race-based discrimination issue. We're going to fight political schedule decarbonization. We're working with states to pass legislation that will allow state investors to fight back against Larry Fink and Ron O'Hanley at State Street's seizure of American capitalism for their personal policy.
There's been one win for us this week. Maybe not for us personally, but it was a win. And I'm sure you didn't have anything to do with this, but Oberlin College had to pay $37 million for discriminating against a bakery right outside of Columbus, Ohio.
That's how we're going to fix this. We conservatives tend to think, the left puts in stupid lawsuits and the left makes laws. We've got to recognize that we're so far in the back foot that it's time for us to start stewing and some very careful and thoughtful legislation, but making some laws, because the goal isn't to sue the fewest times and make the least laws. It's to do the right combination of things to retain freedom as far as we can these days.
I really like the idea of having a diversity of thought law for teachers and college professors.
Yeah. I mean, we're all paying for these services to be provided. And they talk about academic freedom, but it's not academic freedom if it's freedom for you to say whatever you want, but then you and your faculty buddies make sure that nobody who disagrees with you gets hired. That's the opposite. And so if they're not willing to demonstrate academic freedom, we owners of those schools and the payers of those fees ought to step in and require them.
And people wonder what's happening to our freedoms. We're not losing any freedoms. Of course we are.
Oh, God.
There are countless freedoms that we lose because of the left.
This is a slightly older story now, but I listened to a lot of dimwits during the lockdowns. Oh, you're freedoms. Freedom from having a vaccine to help everybody. But yet, it's not a freedom when it's a freedom to abort a child. That it's bodily integrity for abortion, but it's not bodily integrity for an endless stream fully tested vaccines that turned out not to work.
We came from that position when the when the virus first started, we told people there would never be an actual vaccine, and there is not a vaccine. We do not have a vaccine. We have a biologic that will help attenuate symptoms, supposedly. We don't even know for sure that it attenuates symptoms. But a vaccine, by definition, is something that prevents you from contracting the disease. The people most likely to contract COVID-19 at this very moment, right now, are those who have been vaxxed and boosted.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that was the definition before
September.
Before they changed it.
That's right. Just like recession doesn't mean what it's meant since 1976, because, you know.
Yes.
Well, the beauty of it is the CDC changed the definition of a vaccine, except legally the CDC doesn't have that authority.
Well, I mean.
And they did it anyways, but they just really don't have the authority to do it.
With Merrick Garland's Department of Justice, you think legal constraints play any role anymore? That man's as corrupt as anybody since maybe Daugherty in the Harding administration.
Well, why do you think Obama wanted him to be a Supreme Court justice? I mean, come on.
Yeah. But Barack Obama was a straight shooter. He wouldn't have told us that a hard partisan was really a neutral umpire.
Yeah, right.
He's the light bringer.
Yeah, I couldn't see that. So tell folks how they can get involved with Project 21 and your efforts.
Well, I'm at the Free Enterprise Project. Project 21 is a group of Black conservatives, and I don't want anybody to think I've mistook
You're appropriating Black conservatism.
That's right. But you can reach Project 21 or the Free Enterprise Project at nationalcenter.org. Free Enterprise Project is freeenterpriseprojects.org. I've got a weekly piece at Real Clear Markets if you want to keep up that way with what we're up to. And please do, for your watchers and listeners, get in touch with us. We're always here.
So we'll put links in the show notes. So just go to bluntforcetruth.com with the episode with Scott Shepard, and you'll find links to all of Scott's contacts, website, and the book also that Chuck recommended. That will be there too.
Yeah, Chuck, what was that? All right, good.
It's called Freedom at Midnight, and it's historically true. So it could be taught in colleges, but of course they wouldn't do that, because Lord Mountbatten had something to do with it, and Winston Churchill and people like that.
Well, if they could rewrite the first half to somehow make it Britain's fault, everything that, because systemic race, you know, the building of those railroads is what caused the classes and the untouchable classes and the race hatred and the religious hatred in India. It was all Britain.
Right. Sure it was. It was never there before
herself,
they got there.
The queen herself was invading those countries.
Yeah. That's right.
If you listen to MSNBC, she was.
Scott Shepard, Free Enterprise. What is it, Free Enterprise?
Free Enterprise Project.
Yep. Listen, thank you so much for coming on the show. We really appreciate it. We always appreciate your time. And I know our listeners do as well. And folks, if you enjoyed today's show, leave us a good review on iTunes, Stitcher, Podcast One. We would certainly appreciate that. And we'll see you next time on Blunt Force Truth.
How long does it take to tackle a home project? With Angie, you could cross it off your list before this ad is over. Just tell us what you need, indoor or outdoor, repair or redesign, and they handle the rest, sending a top pro to get it done. You don't have to lift a finger. Well, maybe except to tap the screen or click the mouse. Plus, Angie is free to use. So bring them your next home product, and they will bring it home. Download the app or go to Angie.com. That's ANGI.com to get started.
New message.
What up, what up? It's Heather's cousin. You dated her in college, or maybe you were just in the same class. Anyway, I heard you bought a boat, my man. Let's hit the water. Oh, and Heather told me you always liked snacks and stuff, so I could totally bring some chips.
When you get a boat, you also get new friends. Make sure Progressive's one of them, and get coverage today for as little as $100 a year.
Hey, also, I'm a little short on cash, so can you cover the chips? Thanks. I can see why Heather liked you.
Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Annual premium for basic liability policy not available in all states.